Thank you very much, President Meyer, President Harrison. I want to share with all of you folks, only a person who is not normal would invite a man to come and speak to your convention that has absolutely no education. All of you sitting here have more education than I have. When I think of you, Judge, and all the years of your education and your qualification, and here is an old farmer from Western Iowa that has absolutely no education. God calls all kinds of people to get his work done. How many of you are laymen here? Stand up, laymen.
Please stand.
Every one of the laymen, please stand up. Stay standing. Quit clapping. I want to share with all of you here, I've just got a few short minutes, and this will probably be the last time I'll get to see you here on earth, because I'm dying. And you're dying too. Every day, we're one day closer going to our real home. But I want to tell every one of you laymen standing up, if the church is going to grow, it's not going to grow because of the pastors only. It's going to grow because of people like you, because every one of you is a missionary. And if somebody comes to you and says, are you a real missionary? The words yes must come out of your mouth. You are people called by God. And I want you, every one of you, to know you can tell people about Jesus too. Thank you very much. Sit down. I don't talk up on stage. I never go up near the altar. I've spoken now in more than 1,700 churches in the United States and Canada. Every Sunday, I'm in a different church, but I don't go up to the altar, the pulpit. I have no right to, but I can give a report. And I'll tell you why. Because the majority of people in the Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod, it's time to wake up. You know what I find when I travel to churches? The majority of people are dead asleep. You know what you're wondering right now, if you're normal? I wonder how long this guy's going to talk. I hope it isn't too long. I spoke in a big church up in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. The head elder came over to me before I gave my report. I can't preach. I had one pastor say to me, you're in violation of the Augsburg Confession, the small called articles, and the Book of Concord. You have no right to be speaking in these churches. Boy, I was glad he didn't mention the Bible. I want to share with you folks, my job is to give a report because 99% of the people don't have a clue what's going on in mission. And that head elder said to me, and he tapped his watch, he said, we got rules here. 1 hour and you're done. How many of you know where the church is really growing and the Holy Spirit's working? Ethiopia. They're baptizing an average of 1,000 people a day there. In November, their membership exceeded 9 million. Their services are 4 to 6 hours. The Holy Spirit is really, really working there. 9 million members in November. That's 4 times the membership of the Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod. What are they doing? What are they doing that we're not doing? Our church for the last 10 years has decreased. That isn't what the Lord Jesus wants us to do. So it's time to wake up. And I want to share with you, it's time to be not normal. I want to share with you, I'm sick of normal people. I don't want to work and I don't have time for normal people anymore. You know what normal people say? Boy, the congregation ought to do something. That's what normal people say. Boy, the congregation ought to do something. Pastor, you ought to do something. You ought to work harder. No, it's up to us. The lay people have to come awake, and it's time to be different. We're in the world, but not of the world. You understand what I'm saying? We're different. And it's all about Jesus. You know, the older I get, I'm 76 years old. The only schooling I've had is the school of hard knocks. I saw God's hand of blessing in my life. I started at the Mapleton Trust and Savings Bank when I was 18 years old for a dollar an hour filing checks in the bookkeeping department, and I want to tell you, I saw God's hand of blessing in my life. He had a plan for me. And I became president of that bank, and God blessed me in a wonderful way. I had a dad that went to the fourth grade. He wore bib-striped overalls all the time. And Dad never read the Bible all the way through, but he knew Jesus loved him and died for him. He had a childlike faith, and that's what saves. You don't have to have all the exegetical and theological answers to tell people about Jesus. I wonder when's the last time you layperson, when's the last time you told somebody about Jesus? It's all about Jesus. I spoke in a big church out in Denver. I'll never forget, the pastor got up and he said to the whole congregation, if you got your eyes and thoughts on something other than Jesus, you're off base. I want to share with you, I spoke in a big church in Lincoln, Nebraska. They worship about 2,000 people there on a weekend. And the pastor said, could you have like a children's message? I said, I love children. You know what? Little children get it. Little children get it. The more I think about this, in Matthew 18:3, Jesus took a little child, put that little child on his lap, and he looked over at the Pharisees. They had all the exegetical and theological answers. And he said to them, unless you change and become like this little child, you'll not enter into my kingdom. When I had that children's message, there were 70, 80 little kids up there. And I said, you see these big people out here? A lot of them have forgotten what the mission of the church is. I said, do you children know what the mission of the church is? Finally, a little 7-year-old girl with blonde hair raised her hand slowly. I looked at her and I said, honey, what's the mission of the church? She looked at me and said, don't you know? Whoa. I said, well, honey, I think I know. But what do you think? I wonder if I handed out a piece of paper to all of you dear folks and said, write down the mission of the church, I wonder how many different answers I'd get. And yet that little girl made me cry. She looked at me so innocently, she said, it's telling people about Jesus. That's the mission of the church. Is that complicated? And yet it's so hard for people to understand. You know, Martin Luther preached a sermon. It's in volume 69 of Luther's works, recently translated. And he spoke about this verse, John 20:21. When Jesus, on Easter Sunday evening, he suddenly appeared in a room. Boom! Jesus could be right here with us in this room. You think he is? He's standing right up there by President Meyer. He's right there next to you. Because he said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. And Luther wrote about John 20:21, when Jesus' first words were, as he suddenly appeared after the resurrection. He said, Shalom. Peace be unto you. And then he said, as the Father sent me, I'm sending you. Luther said specifically in that sermon of April 23rd, 1523 at Wittenberg, he said, that command applies to all Christians. That applies to each and every one of us. As the Father has sent me, I'm sending you. Oh, there's still a lot of people like Thomas who said, I got to put my finger in here before I believe. But how many of you here in this auditorium know what the very last words of Jesus was? He's ascending into heaven, and he looks back at his followers, and what does he say? He said, go into
the world.
Go into
the world.
Go into
the world.
All the world. Now that starts at home. And when I go to churches, I've heard this. Oh, Gary, you're all excited about this mission work, but we got to take care of our own. We got to take care of our own. Every person in this auditorium knows about the Lord Jesus. And if you truly believe in him, I'll get to see you again. I never say goodbye to Christian friends. I always say, see you later. It's about the people who have never heard the name of Jesus. I think that's so important. We remember that Mark 16, 15. That's a command. That's not an option. Oh, our mission is we do this, and this is our mission. Jesus said, go into
all the world.
Now you're kicking. That's good. There's that little child that Jesus had in Matthew 18, 3. Had that little child on his lap. The older I get, the more I understand. Little children get it. I spoke in a church in Columbus, Nebraska. I noticed there was a little 7-year-old girl sitting right with her mom and dad. She was electrified. She never even blinked. She paid attention. When I left there, I always talk about our missionaries. A week later, I got an envelope from that little girl. It made me cry. I opened up that letter that she had written herself. She said, Missionary Gary, I was paying attention when you were talking. Enclosed is my gift for that missionary that you talked about. That's one of the largest gifts I've ever received in 24 years. There were 13 $1 bills in there. She said, you give this to this missionary. I can't go to these lands of darkness, but I can help send someone. And then what really made me cry, she sent a picture. She sent a picture. Do you get it? That little girl went home, and what did she do? She took it personally. You know what's wrong in the church today? We don't take Jesus personally. I want you to take it real personally today. Dale, you take this personally now. Think. Who did Jesus die for, Dale? Take it personally.
Me.
Say it nice and loud, Dale.
Me.
Jesus died for?
Me.
Jesus died for me. He died for everyone. But first of all, he died for me. And he knows your name. And he knew when you were born, you were going to be a pastor. God's got this thing all figured out. And that little girl went home and she took it personally. I want to share with all of you, the more I travel, little kids get it. See that little girl there? I spoke in a big Lutheran church, Lutheran school. And there was a whole bunch of kids there, and I said to those children, I said, children, there are people in this town that don't know about Jesus. Who ought to tell them? Boy, those kids just look like that. I said, who ought to tell them? Finally, this little 5-year-old girl sat right up front. She just very gently raised her hand. I said, honey, who should tell them? She made me cry. She looked up at me and she said, me, I ought to tell. I want to share with you, the older I get, the simpler it gets. See that man right there? I met him quite a number of years ago. There was a small group. See, only not normal people come like to an evening event. Normal people are too busy. But anyhow, this guy was there. And the Holy Spirit still works, folks. I want to share with you, the church does not need fundraisers. If you called me a fundraiser, I'd be offended. The church needs faith raisers. Somebody out to tell the story. Who's out telling the story of what the Lord Jesus is doing in his mission field? So I spoke that night, and after I got through speaking, this gentleman right here came up. You know how old he was? 90. He said, something happened in my heart tonight. He said, you know something, Missionary Gary? I never really thought about this, but you know, I can't go to these lands of darkness to tell people about Jesus who've never heard his name, but I could send someone in my place. He said, I got farmland and I've got income and I'm doing nothing. He said, I want to do something for Jesus. I said, John, you got it. God will call you. He said, you got a card? Oh, yeah, I said, here's my card. Now, I could tell there was a change in John. Now, do you know what happens to most people? And I've had this happen so many times. They get all excited and say, Gary, have you got a card? Oh, yeah. And then Monday comes and everything goes back to
normal.
Boy, you guys are awake. I thought you were asleep. Yeah, it goes back to normal. And then, oh, yeah, that guy was kind of interesting. And then there go. It wasn't that way with John. John sent me a letter and a huge check. More than about 5 or 6 congregations put together. He said, Missionary Gary, will you help me pick out the missionaries that need help? Do you folks all know in this auditorium that our missionaries now have to raise 100% of their own support? The majority of people don't even know that. They think, oh, when I put my gift in the plate on Sunday morning, that'll pay for all the missionaries. These missionaries we're sending out. Pastor Donald Neundorf, who spoke at the service this morning, his son's going to go to the mission field. They got to raise their own support. We've got to be a part of that. And then 3 months later, John sent the same amount of check. And 3 months later, John sent the same amount of check. And 3 months later, John sent the same amount of check. I went down to see John on his birthday, not too long ago, his 100th birthday. There you go. Woke up at 90. And that guy right there has done way more than I don't know how many entire congregations. That's what God can do. I get to meet the most wonderful people. See that lady right there? That's Clara Gutz. I met her 24 years ago. As soon as I met Clara, I knew immediately she was not
normal.
She was not normal. She really got it. And little Claire and I have written back and forth, and she's just a wonderful soul. Met her in Osmond, Nebraska, all these years. This last year, I went back to speak at Osmond. I got up and looked, and I said, hey, where's Clara? They said, oh, Gary, didn't you know? She's gone to the nursing home. Whoa. I said, I know where I'm going right after church service. You know where I'm going? Nursing home. I went right out there. I got to see my friend Clara. And we prayed together and had a chance to talk about Jesus another time. Clara's 102 years old. I got ready to go, and little old Clara said, Missionary Gary, before you go, she reached over to her little dresser, opened the drawer, pulled out a check. She said, would you see that the missionary that needs it gets this check? 102 years old, still doing something for Jesus. I want to share with you that man. This is very common. When I go to churches and talk about the mission of going into all of the world, I run into some very interesting comments. As the people were going out of church, a man like this grabbed a hold of my hand. He said, you know, Missionary Gary, you had a pretty interesting talk. But to be quite truthful, we don't need to be sending these missionaries to Africa and China. We got enough work to do right here in this country. Oh, I said, I agree with you, this third largest mission field. But I said, there's a big difference in this country. I said, every little town and village you go to has one of these buildings, you know, like this, with a cross on the top. It's filled with people. I said, do you know who it's filled with? Missionary, and they don't know it. Do you understand what I'm saying? I looked at him and I said, when's the last time you told somebody about Jesus? You're a missionary. We're loaded with missionaries here, but they don't know it. He looked at me and he said, nobody's ever talked to me like that before. Time to wake up. I said, you know, Jesus' command said go into all the world. That's not an option. That's a command. See, everyone in the United States knows the name of Jesus. In foreign countries, you can go to some of these countries, they never heard of Jesus before. They never heard his name. Now, some of you said, hey, wait a minute. He said to everybody, all you have to do is have a man hit his thumb with a hammer, and you'll find out how quickly he knows the name of Jesus. I met this couple a number of years ago. I was speaking, and they came up to me after the service. They said, "Missionary Gary, we don't go to the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. We just were visiting today. But do you think we could support some missionaries?" I said, "Is the Pope Catholic? Is the sky blue? Is the grass green?" I've written for 18 years to these people. Every month, they send a gift every month for three of our LCMS missionaries. What wonderful Christian people. I had that picture taken in my office. I worked for the guy on the right-hand side. I worked direct. And I want you to know those faithful Christian people are members of the Baptist Church. I wonder how many of you realize in this auditorium that the largest supporter of our missionaries through Mission Central is not a member of the Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod. I wonder how many of you knew that. Interesting how God works. Well, there it is. That's a miracle place. I believe in miracles. I expect them. We've had 5,000 visitors this year, and the only kind of people that come to this place are people who are not
normal.
That's exactly right. You see our office right there? Can you all see our office right there? That's where my office is. We have three bedrooms upstairs for our missionaries. This past year, we had 118 missionaries and their family members from all over the world come here. And they speak here in our barn. See that barn? I hauled 21 loads of manure out of that barn. That's a lot of manure. Now, that was the hog house. We used that as our fellowship hall. We had to clean all the hog manure out of there. But that was too small, so we had to build our ministry center, and then just this last year, we completed our creation theater. I'll get to show you that. That little wayside prayer chapel was built by volunteers. And we're averaging five people a day to stop and pray there, and I don't have a clue who they are. Interesting how God can use. That's my office in that old farmhouse. A lot of people don't know the magnitude of God's blessing here on Mission Central. That day, we had 400 envelopes come in with gifts for our missionaries. You know the interesting thing? Can you see the picture of my boss in the background there? I'm sorry, President Harrison, your picture is not there. Thank you for laughing, President Harrison. I want you to take a look at this picture. You see what that is? That's our volunteer staff. 102 volunteers. 102 volunteers. None of them get paid. You know the worst kind of volunteer you can have? Come in and says, "What are we going to do today?" Every one of those volunteers has a title. I want to share with all of you here today, I wouldn't be here if God hadn't sent a wonderful friend who said to me, "Gary, I can't get up and talk, but I could get you there." We have five volunteer pilots that fly me. And what a wonderful blessing to have my dear friend Harry Barr from Lincoln, Nebraska fly me here. If you think I would have flown commercial, I'm sick of commercial airlines. I'm sick of late flights, I'm sick of changes, I'm sick of long lines, and I'm sick of all this inspection stuff. So if I'm going to go anywhere, if the pilots don't fly me, I'm not going. Ladies and gentlemen, the most important person in this entire auditorium is sitting right over there, Mr. Harry Barr. Stand up, Harry. Stand up. That's what God can do. God sends people to us just the right time. Now, those of you that are interested in Mission Central, I want you to know that you can go to missioncentral.us. Last month, we had 20,000 visitors to this not normal place. You'll see the stories. If you go under not normal news, you'll be shocked. I want you to know all of those people right there are part of that. We operate this thing with no overhead. One lady said to me, "Well, you've got overhead. You've got lights and upkeep and maintenance, insurance, and LP gas." I said, "Oh, sure. But what do you think I was doing for 33 years getting ready for this?" She said, "Well, you don't pay for that." The church ought to pay for that. You know what kind of woman she was? Normal. God has blessed me for a reason and purpose. I've deeded all of our farms and everything that I have to this, so this keeps going after I'm in heaven. See that picture right there? That guy on the right-hand side, he'll be able to go to every church. He's a pastor. He's got his doctorate in theology, 16 years in the mission field. That's Dr. Reverend Brent Smith. I interviewed him 24 years ago before he went to Kazakhstan. And as soon as I interviewed him, I started to cry because I knew he was the one. But I had to wait 24 years for him. And the time was right. I said, Brent, I'm 76. I'm not retiring. If any of you say, oh, that Gary, he retired. You know what Dad taught me when we was cutting cockaburs and sunflowers out of the corn? I said, Dad, you think we could rest? He said, son, you can rest when you're dead. I want to share with you that young man will carry on when I'm in heaven waiting for you. The work of Mission Central is so critical. We don't have to take anything out for the operations of Mission Central. And it all started there in 1994 in the basement of our home. In a very small way, God called me. Now I want to share with you, if any of you are sleeping now, if any of you are sleeping up there in the back, wake up, would you? Because the next picture I'm going to show you is a miracle picture. I took this picture on March the 4th of 2004. I walked out to the highway there after Maxine had the driveway scooped out. And I walked out there and I turned and I took the picture of our sign at Mission Central in the snow. And then I downloaded the picture when I got to the office and I showed it to my secretary and she started to cry. This is a miracle picture. There's no cross to the right of the sign. No cross there. You come out, see, there's no cross there. And suddenly this cross appears. I want to share with you, we were all shocked, and then I begin to look. And this is the light pole for the parking lot, and in the distance, that's a terrace with brush growing up in the terrace. I didn't see that when I took the picture. You think God still talks to us? He said, this is my place. You know what normal people say? You sure were lucky. Boy, that was a coincidence. That's what normal people say. That's a miracle picture here in the middle of nowhere in a place called Mission Central. And God has showered down his blessing. And it's an amazing thing because that bus is from Wisconsin, Michigan, South Dakota, Minnesota. See all them people coming up there? They'll spend a day there. It's a miracle place, but the only kind of people that come here are people who are not
normal.
That's right. I want to share with you, we have lots of people. Lots of people that come in buses. We built a new ministry center. We made a horrible mistake. Can you see what the mistake is?
Too small.
Too small. I took this picture, and I want you to know that picture right there. I counted people from five states. See, the people that come to Mission Central are not normal. They don't care how far they drive. Normal people say, oh, we don't have time. We were in church Sunday, Pastor. That's enough. That's the way the barn looked when we started. It's the worst looking place you've ever seen. Have any of you ever heard of buyer's remorse? Whoa. I want to tell you, and God said, don't worry, Gary, I'm with you. That's the same building. And I want you to know people come by the thousands to that old barn. We have the most fabulous museum in there. Artifacts from around the world. We have missionaries bring us, and I've had the privilege of traveling to 75 countries to film the work of our missionary. And I want to share with you, I got stuff in that museum. We have things in there that nobody has seen. Unbelievable. Take a look at that little snake up there. That's the largest African python you've ever seen. And now we know God has called us in another way. He's called us in a special way. Can you tell me when I'm done, how much time have I got?
15.
15 minutes. Thank you. See that right there? That's our new creation theater. 23 years ago, a man said, I shot these animals for my family. I said, Ron, you should show these. He said, they're for my family only. He died last year. His wife called me and said, Gary, would you be interested in the trophies? I said, let me talk to my boss. His picture's above my desk here. And after I talked to him, I called her back. I said, I'm bringing the tape measure because we got to figure out how big a building to put up. You know what we got to do? We got to tell people what happened on the sixth day of creation. You know what these young people are getting when they go to college? High school. Why, the story of creation is a joke. And so God gave us creation theater. And we have the background like the jungles of Africa. And these are the animals that God gave us to tell these young people and adults about it. 2 weeks ago, we had over 700 people, that's about the size of your group here, come in 1 week, to hear the story of how God on the sixth day, the morning and evening was one day, and he made all of these animals unique. I want to share with you, it's quite a story, and we're getting thousands of young people to come and hear the real story of how God made everything. Big problem, again, that group, we had to set some people on the floor. It's a fabulous story, and we present it in a very exciting way. I want to talk about missionaries. I see we have some ladies here. I want to share with you, dear, some of our greatest missionaries are ladies. It's real easy to say a missionary, oh, that's got to be a man, and it sure got to be a pastor. I want to share with you, that lady is one of the finest missionaries I've ever worked with. Walmart checkout lady. She said, all my life I wanted to be a missionary. I said, well, can you speak English? She said, yes. I said, we have a place for you in Thailand to teach English. And you can use the Bible stories to teach English. That lady right there, Robin McCoy, went to Thailand. And then she started her missionary journey. Do you see that lady on the left-hand side? That little lady right there is a 17-year-old Thai girl. And when Robin got there, that girl from Thailand came to Robin and said, could I take your class? Yes, Robin said, you can. And they became friends. And after 1 year, that young Thai girl said, Teacher Robin, do you think I could be baptized and be part of the Lord Jesus? He said, you sure can. And little Robin became a Christian. And 6 months later, she came to her teacher and said, Teacher Robin, I have terminal cancer. I'm going to die. And Robin came to my office, made me cry. She said, I held little Sherry in my arms when she was dying. And she looked up at me and said, Teacher Robin, thank you for coming to tell me about Jesus. If you hadn't come, I wouldn't have known about my Savior. I'm going to be with Jesus in my real home, and I'll be waiting for you, Teacher Robin. That was the last word she said. Oh, yes, God has all kinds of people, uses all kinds of people to bring his message. I want to see the hands of the people in this gathering that know that couple right there. Raise your hand. You know, the last time I spoke to your group, Pastor Meyer, he was there. Pastor Larry Matro was there.
Correct.
And now God's called them to the most primitive country I've ever traveled to of the 75 countries I've visited. That country is the jungles of Papua New Guinea, straight north of Australia. And I want to share with you, these are two of the finest missionaries that we have on the field. Just north of Australia is where Papua New Guinea is. It's a land of jungles and mountains. There are still Stone Age people here. It is a primitive country where the roads are very, very bad. And the people are jungle people. You know, I have a little sensitivity in me. You know what the definition of poverty is in this country? somebody who doesn't have a cell phone. I want to share with you, Jesus died for these people. These are jungle people. And Jesus died for them, and they need to know about Jesus. That's part of the Good News Lutheran Church there. They have about 100,000 members. And these are the people we need to go to. There's animistic people that paint their faces white and put on prayer beads when someone passes away. This lady has been chewing betel nut, and Jesus died for her. I want to share with you, this picture makes me think of Numbers. Numbers and the stories there, but it also makes me think of Revelation chapter 7, where John said, "And there I looked and beheld a multitude that no one could count from every nation and language and tribe, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb." You and I are going to stand in front of these people. Those are Christian people. They had a little chapel in their village. These are the people we're reaching out to. These are people right now that your missionary Larry and Tina Matro are meeting with. And they have cultures. Bride price, these are the jungle people. And I think it's important we understand that God called us to go to all the world. Yes, they're different. They have a different culture. Right now, we're dealing with Sanguma, which is connected with witchcraft and witches among these people. But we're helping because here's our first, second, and fourth year seminary students. We have a seminary there. And that's the one that Pastor Larry Matro is helping with. And this is what they have for their lunch. Cow cow, sweet potatoes. And that's one of their dorms. And these are the Bible school students. We're teaching Bible school students to go out and start Bible classes. These are all Sunday school teachers. And their culture is very different. Wonder if your house looks like that. There you go. And these children were so interested when a missionary family came. And they had a little baby. They'd never seen a white baby before. And they saw this little baby of Michael and Beth Ritzman, who were in the jungle there. You know that guy carrying that box? That's Larry Matro. He's carrying it. And I think that box is awfully heavy. And I want to share with you, there's that new little white baby. And of course, what did Pastor Matro get to do? To bring that little baby into the kingdom. That's your pastor right there doing what he was called to do. There were hundreds and hundreds of people that came to see that baptism of that little white baby. And there you see Pastor Matro in a Bible class there. That's your pastor right here from the district. And there you see him with a men's Bible study group. There you see him with a group that he's just handed those Bibles to. They had never had Bibles before. And he's walking across one of the bridges there. How'd you like to walk across that bridge? There he is in the white going across there. You sent him. You remember what Jesus said, his last words, "Go into all the world." I want to share with all of you here, it's been a wonderful, wonderful blessing to have this opportunity. And you know, if there's just one person in this gathering, if there's just one person in this gathering that wakes up, then this trip was all worthwhile. I want to share with you, if God can use an uneducated, unschooled man like me, he can use every one of you here. But you have to take Jesus personally, because Jesus died for me and he knows my name. I was normal until I was about 51 years old, and then a death changed my life. Oh, there was a time in my life, I'm the worst sinner you've ever met. There was a time in my life when the only thing important to me was buying another farm and making more money. Then I woke up and all these things don't mean anything. See, normal people are like this. Gee, Gary, I didn't realize that these missionaries had to raise 100% of their own support. Boy, we got to do something. Here's $10. That'll take care of it. and they drive off in their new Cadillac Escalade to their million-dollar home. The resources are unbelievable that are out here. It's all about heart business. So I want to ask you, I hope the rest of your life you'll be people who are different. That people might look at you, Paul, and say to you, Paul, you're different. You're not normal. You want them to say that. Has your wife ever told you that, Paul? Give you that. I hope I haven't offended any of you. My hope and prayer is that this maybe has helped you to come awake, to realize that Jesus knows your name. And the one verse that changed my life dramatically when I left the bank was this word, these words from Ephesians 2:10. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which he's prepared in advance for us to do. God has a plan for each and every one of you sitting here at these tables. A plan for everyone. We just have to allow it to happen. Let's pray. Oh, good and gracious God, thank you for loving us so much that you gave us Jesus, the greatest gift of all. And because of that gift, none of us in this room have to say, I hope we'll be in heaven. No, we know for certain. Not by what we've done, but by what Jesus did on the cross. And because of his goodness and grace, this world is not our home. Heaven is our home. And Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless each and every one of these dear friends that are in this room. They're all part of our real family because we all have the same home. Lord, we ask your blessing on the Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod. We think so many times of the attacks of the devil, and there's such darkness in the world today. As I travel, I see a darkness in this country, Lord, like I've never seen before. And Heavenly Father, we ask that you awaken all of the people here. Especially, Lord, we ask your blessing on President David Meyer as he is president of this district. Give him courage to make hard decisions. Give him a zeal that people might know that he's so different. He's not normal. And Heavenly Father, help us to know that every person in this auditorium is a missionary. A witness for you. And all this we ask with grateful hearts. In the name of Jesus, our risen and living Savior, who's standing right here with us this morning, we ask this all in his precious name. Amen. Now, I plan on seeing you all later. You know that, don't you? And I will be so happy to see you. God bless you and keep you, and I won't forget you. And Judge, I won't forget you. We need more judges like you.